So Sarah, welcome here in Paris.
Oh, thank you.
So you just gave your talk at the main stage. So you're from the Freelancers Union.
Yes.
So what is the Freelancers Union?
We're a union of freelance workers. We're about 300,000 strong. We're based in the U.S., although always get so much interest from people all over the world in joining. And so people can come to our website and form a hive from whatever country they want to be in and then start participating with us. And the goal is to help people connect and find one another, but also to provide benefits and things that they need. And then probably most importantly, to start talking about what's the next way we're going to have an economy and how we as workers can start to frame that discussion.
And how long is it now existing?
It's 19 years.
19 years. And what do you see looking really short changing? From 19 years ago and now is also really accelerating and what changes do you see or do you see changes?
Yeah, you know, it's funny, 19 years ago when you said there's going to be this new world of work and people are going to work in this new way and it'll be gig based and project based, they'd be like, really? And when you'd say freelancer, they'd think somebody who was unemployed, you know, or somebody who stayed home in their pajamas all day. And now it's just everybody's really starting to realize that. I'd say governments may be the slowest, but in terms of the society. And so I think that really is the big change that we're seeing from now. And then I'd say the acceleration is that the people who are the entrepreneurs and the movers and the thinkers are starting to see that either this is a market they want to go after or this is a group that they want to employ. And that business and investment and money, I think, is moving this really fast.
And is it moving in the right direction with the money?
You know, it's funny. I think it is what it is in a lot of ways. And I think a lot about the way the railroads for all of every country on earth changed the terrain. And that power was so intense that it wasn't like you could change the direction of the change. Maybe train, maybe some could here or there, but that's the piece that I think we have to see as the defining force. And then we will start to be able to respond and say, this is what we need. Maybe the train doesn't go over here, but the main lines are now really being redrawn as much as when we had big factories coming in. And those towns that got a big factory had a very different economy than the rural areas where there was no factory.
Yeah. Yeah, and I also think that the trains are in a different direction, but nobody knows where the end station is, or if there is only one end station, or there may be 1,000.
Yeah, you know, I really agree with that, and I think in some ways, the parallel for me is the internet is like the trains. It's like that powerful and that chaotic and that just, you know, movement. But by the time we got cars, then we started to start saying, wait a minute. Do we want to have cars that go everywhere in a city? We had zoning laws. We started to get much smarter about what we wanted. And I think that that's going to be one of the big changes that in the next really 2 to 3 or 4 or 5 years, we're going to start to be much smarter about how we want this to be ordered. And so right now, I think many of us are like, wow, we're seeing these big changes and we're building up our own constituencies. But at some point, we're going to be able to start saying, whoop, not so fast over here. Or maybe you need to change it here. Or this would be better for not just workers, but really citizens and also the earth, you know? And I think that's what's another really big difference is that this isn't like a workers' movement. We just care about workers. We say we're stakeholders in protecting the earth. And that's because we're the majority of the people. We have to be concerned.
Yeah. And the way you look into the next phase, because getting back to your example of the trains and the cars. So with the train, there was a track and you could jump in the train or not. And with the car, you can create your own path, but in the borders of where is the road and where can I park my car? And do we have a car? And can I pay the gasoline? And do you think that the platforms will be the next level where the barriers of these barriers will be removed?
Well, I think that there's going to be first mover advantage, like the way there is with Google and Facebook, and Amazon, they really put down deep stakes, and they're maybe not going to be around like forever, but you know, they're pretty set. But I think what we're going to start to see is that there'll be new ones that are set. They'll have disrupted some of the ones we will be surprised by. But then I think there's going to be a lot more experimentation and change. And I also think that one of the biggest key drivers is we're going to start understanding different capital flows. So for instance, you know, what I would like to see is a government, and I think the governments that get this ahead of others will be in good shape. They will say, you know, $10 million isn't that much. We're going to create an innovation fund, and we're going to start to fund very local things that we want to see in our communities and that won't have traditional markets. And I think all across the globe, you're going to start seeing the cities that have mayors that get it are going to have really interesting places to live, and the rest, I think, won't. And I think that's where cities will be the leaders in the next era, and they'll be the people who will work in them will be this new workforce.
Yeah, I really agree with that, because the cities, they also have the power because they are sitting with their feet on the ground. So everything they change, they will see directly what the result is.
And they'll be voted out of office very quickly if they don't. There's mayors, I think, are the new interesting thing, and I think the nation state is more in trouble.
And what in your, from your opinion, is then the role of the future of the nation?
You know, I think that nations will probably always be there, but I think the locus of power is both very local and also starting to see, you know, what will be the concentrations. I think we're sort of already seeing this with the EU, that we said it's not going to be, you know, France and Holland and the Netherlands and Germany and Spain and Greece and Italy and anyone else I forgot. But it's going to be one. And so you will see concentrations and regional differences. But at the same time, the real action, I think, will be locally.
Yeah.
And we'll start to really be able to see that. And I think also with these new capital structures, you'll be able to see much more vibrant new cooperative type organizations. One of my favorites is in Canada, actually. It's called the Multi-Stakeholder Cooperative. And I think that that's a really great model that should be looked at.
Yeah, and that's the bright side of the story, the opportunities. But I think because also at the end of your talk, you really had a really deep motivated call for action. There's change, it's positive, but there's also another side of the story. So what are you afraid of?
I think the thing I'm most fearful of is that there won't be enough work. If we think about work as the 40-hour a week job, I'm just quite confident that it won't be. And I think that's why so many people are calling for minimum income strategies and saying that we have to start to think about how are we going to have a basic support for all people. And I think that's going to be really critical. And I do worry about that. And I worry also about the effect of climate change and that the people who are the wealthiest are going to be the most protected, and workers are really going to be struggling. And I think we're going to have to reinvent solidarity, because solidarity is not just a beautiful word and a beautiful song. It's really because people realize it's in their best interest. You know, just like in Holland with the people who started realizing their country was underwater and they wanted to farm it, and they said, if we farm it together, and we're all in this together, we actually can succeed. If we just focus on our own plot of land, we lose. And so I think these are going to be the forces that are going to say, to affect and protect ourselves with climate change, we better get together. We better have common strategies. We better have governments that get that. And workers have organizing principles and organizations that will enable them to be part of that.
Yeah, I agree about it. And when you look at about labor also on platforms, not only knowledge, but also working like Uber on platforms, because now the world is I think it's complex, but it's really simple when you look back, let's say over 10 years, because now everybody is working in a city or in a country, there are physical organizations, when you have something to complain, you can knock on the door and they might open, or their lawyers will open.
Yes.
When people are going to work more on platforms, then this control is well, not completely gone, but it's a lot tougher.
Yes.
How do you think that the rights for workers can be protected in such a really confusing, decentralized, international a world where also different cultures who are thinking different about the rights of laborers than we do.
Yeah, no, I think that that is totally the right question, and that the way that people are envisioning platforms in this year of 2015 is very individualized. I go to Uber, I get a car, somebody who's driving the car comes to pick me up. And I think that what we at Freelancers Union are starting to realize is we know how to group people together using platforms. And so, for instance, in New York, where we have our biggest group of people getting health insurance, we've learned how to structure things so that we can then have a relationship and we can literally call the CEO of the company for one of our members. That member can never call the CEO, but we can.
Yep.
And we can find out from the members what's going on with them. And so I think that we're in a very early stage, but the next stage is that the social sector is going to learn how to organize and come together. I'm convinced of it. 2015 is a little early, but without a doubt, I think we're going to start seeing a way to come back together as groups.
And they also say, because I really believe that's the big examples we hear when it comes to name them again, because they're already in every video, interview, podcast, what you will watch or listen from WeShareFest. Do you really believe that's a temporary solution? But in the end, because I believe it is, and I really believe that they paved the way for the next more value-driven and social and not VC-driven organization. But do you also think that you as organization can play a role in that and facilitate? Because how many taxi drivers are member of your organization?
Right. I mean, well, part not only that, but they're coming to us to be together in a group. And so there's only a matter of time before they can start articulating what they want. But I think that what's really important is back, you know, 20 and 30 years ago, if you started a nonprofit or an NGO, the scaling strategy was you created the experiment and then government would come in and do it. And so what's happened is government no longer plays that role, and the only group that has this kind of money are the venture capitalists. And I think that we probably want to start to think about what are some other goals, because again, venture capitalists have other people's money. They have to invest it in a way that gets those returns or they're not doing their job. And there's plenty of activity that doesn't have that kind of market activity in it. So who's going to do that? And I think that's the really interesting part, because the social sector will be able to use these platforms, will be able to build these new structures. They'll be more local. So I agree, on the one hand, they're building the trains, and those trains had to be built by, you know, the biggest robber baron, wealthy people in the world. But it ends at a certain point, because that's what a democracy is. And I think if we think that this is going to be the only way we're going to get stuff done, then I don't think we're thinking democracy anymore.
And what will be the role of your union in speeding this up?
Well, I think that the social sector has to start to talk about society and the social aspects of the economy. And it's not because we have big hearts. It's because we have rational minds. And if you don't pay attention to infrastructure, and I'll give you a good example. The big crisis that's happening right now is that we have massive income inequality and the middle class is declining all across the globe, especially in Europe and in the US and UK, et cetera. And so they're not consuming as much. Why do we care? Growth in every single one of our countries is spurred by spending, and we aren't spending. So I guarantee you, it is May 2015. In a year, we are going to start seeing we're in a crisis because we're not growing. And if you look, nobody is spending. And that is a big problem. And so you can build all those platforms that you want, but we're going to keep having a 1% if we just do it like that. And so we all need each other. And so that's the thing I think is so interesting, is that frequently it looks like the platform builders are the tough investment people and the social sector are the women. But what's so wrong about that is that it's an ecosystem, and that you have to have economic goals. And I think we are very much a part of what those goals are, and will be critical to the whole enterprise.
Yeah, cool. So keep on doing that, and talk to you maybe next year, and then we'll see what happened, what changed, and how we can get this forward.
Great. Thank you.